Ja, alle. Good morning. We'll do this panel in English. So those of you who have a problem with English, use the headphones. And my panelists can all conduct the conversation in English. Great pleasure to have a wonderful panel here around me, and I will very briefly introduce them in around the table in this order. And I will not even just look at my notes, because I can say that I've known all of them for, most of them for a very long time. Jackson James is the president and CEO of the American Institute for Contemporary German Studies. Not an easy name to remember, but one that I've,
you said it.
learned to spell. To his, one of the best experts on transatlantic and German-American relations, needless to say. To his left, Elmar Brock, who told me a week ago that he is now, and I thought that was the case, but he confirmed to me that he is now the longest serving member of the European Parliament. He's been a member of the European Parliament for 35 years, correct? And he's of course also the chairman of the Foreign Relations Committee. Has played a key role in the convention on that led to the Lisbon Treaty, etc., etc. So welcome, Elmar. Mustafa, where do I have your card? Just a minute. Nayem is a member of the Ukrainian Parliament. The Ukrainian Parliament, which was elected last year, and which has, of course, still some from the old days and many from the new days, including, of course, from the Maidan movement. It's now a more colorful parliament with huge problems, challenging the fabric of Ukrainian society. So we're very happy to have you, Mustafa, with us here this morning. Anne-Marie Gloanec is sort of the opposite to Jackson James, one of those French men or women who know more about Germany than anyone else. Anne-Marie has lived in and worked in Germany, is a scholar, and we've known each other for, I think, 30 years or so. So welcome to you. And last not least, Professor Sergei Karaganov. Sergei and I have the, I'm not sure whether this is actually a privilege, but it's a burden to serve together on this so-called panel of eminent persons, which was created by the OSCE, where we struggle, both of us, together with 11 or 12 others, to come up toward the end of the year with some considerations, some suggestions about how to improve the architecture of European security, given the tragedies and failures of the recent past that was just described to us so wonderfully this morning by Professor Winkler and also the German Defense Minister. We don't have very much time, and this is why you're not going to hear long speeches by our panelists. I thought maybe I should not start with the Russia and Ukraine crisis right away, but kick us off with an opening shot at the Syrian issue, which I think is first and foremost on everybody's mind, whether you are French or German, and I think also from a Russian or American angle, what goes on in Syria, in the Middle East and in Europe must be an issue of great concern. So, I mean, looking back 20 years ago, we waited until more than 100,000 people had perished until we finally decided to take action. In the case of Ukraine, the West decided that there was no useful good military option, right? In the case of Syria, if I remember correctly, there used to be some red lines. There are now activities by France to combat, along with some others, the Islamic State from the air. There has been extensive discussion, not in Germany, but outside of Germany, about such issues as no-fly zones, how to protect civilians in and around Syria. Is there something that could be done? Russia is, of course, supplying weapons and providing training and soldiers to Syria in a different way than the West. Is there something that you think could or should be done in order to get at the roots of the problem rather than talk about fences and humanitarian aid and welcoming hundreds of thousands to Europe? What do you say?
Let me start out by making a comment, which I think might be directed not only to the Europeans in this room, but to the Americans. And the comment is, vision without execution is hallucination. And I think that to some extent, what we have here is a vision without execution. Whether it be dealing with the crisis here in Europe at the moment with the refugee problem that we talked about before, or whether it be dealing with the apparent inability to understand where those red lines are. I think that the lesson that I would suggest that we need to do here is to figure out what is in fact the threat, what is in fact the common objective, and to some extent, where can we find common ground to put the right tools in the toolbox and not use those from the 19th or the 20th century.
Thank you. Anne-Marie, from a French point of view, shouldn't we have some kind of Franco-German joint thinking, joint planning in the context of what we call, European common foreign and security policy? Where is the Franco-German joint action here? France is considering or actually acting. I don't see much togetherness here. Give me your personal view.
I'm going to be very blunt. I don't think there is any kind of understanding between French and German on military questions, there is a Franco-German axis in very many ways, sometimes jointedly as far as the Euro crisis is concerned. There is some understanding on the question of quotas, cringingly from the part of the French, but I mean, we have made advances there. Concerning security, I haven't seen anything, and I don't see anything is coming in the near future, in the sense that the French have been very early on calling for safe zones. The French president, I will recall you, was in favor of it, I think, in January 2013. It was not followed. It was very vague at the time, right? And safe zones itself creates a problem, because how are you going to defend safe zone? From above or from the ground? I mean, it's an open-ended question, which is very difficult. But there are strikes from the part of the French, from the part of the UK, first starting in Iraq and currently now in Syria, and the British Parliament is going to vote on that. And even French public opinion would be in favor of boots on the ground. I don't see anything here going in that direction, either in opinion polls nor in the government. In the opinion, well, we talked about it a bit earlier, opinion polls can be, I mean, opinion can be changed, right? We see it in particular concerning the refugee crisis. But to what extent can it be really led in a Germany where political culture has become so risk adverse concerning the military? Your foreign minister the other day was criticizing the French and British strikes on Syria on this point. So I don't believe in CSDP. I will be very frank. There can be minor military operations that, or almost civilian operations at the border of civilian military like we have in the Mediterranean to try to fight against the smugglers and to rescue people who are crossing the Mediterranean and to fight against the smugglers. I think this is going to increase. But when we have a robust military intervention, no, there will be always coalitions of the willing. Now, I have a footnote here. Is it possible to have military interventions besides strikes from the sky, especially in both in the context of Syria, which is extremely complex, and also at a time when the West doesn't believe in military interventions anymore because of, look at Afghanistan, look at Iraq, we are very wary about these.
Sergei, look, discussions about which we read in our newspapers between Americans and Russians about maybe having some military discussions about how to deal with Syria. Both of the leaders, Obama and Putin, are going to be in New York next week. Do you think that there is room for some kind of understanding that could lead to some kind of new dialogue, at least on the military and maybe also on the political level, between Russia and the United States that could bridge the silence that has existed since the annexation of Crimea a year and a half ago?
You mean, of course, a glorious reunification with Crimea, of Crimea with Mother Russia. Yes, I think there is a possibility, but there must be some prerequisites, and that is doing away with the ideological element in the policies of our partners and going back to competence and realism. Policies of our partners have been incompetent and unrealistic. Supporting democracy in the Middle East is oxymoron. And it led to Libya, and by the way, we're talking about Syria, but Libya is not less a problem. It nearly led to Egypt. There was a coup d'etat, a counter coup d'etat, and thanks God now we have some stability. And it went, and of course we had Iraq, where forces went to install democracy. If we decide that our common end is stability and peace, we could work together. And I hope that we will come to our senses. And maybe then we will find some operational ways to cooperate, like creating zones for Christians, Alawites in Syria, like helping Kurds and maybe helping some other indigenous forces and joining forces with Iran, which had been condemned for decades, also after a very interesting policy of the United States, which led to this sequence of events. Then hopefully we will be able at least to contain the problem. I'm not sure we could solve it, even if we join forces now.
Thank you, Sergei. In our panel of the so-called eminent persons, when we met just a few days ago, it's about a dozen statesmen, women, former heads of state, former foreign ministers, and others. I think the one thing we agreed on rather easily was that what we experience here today, because of what has been going on in Ukraine and because of what's now going on in the Middle East, this is probably the single most dangerous moment in history in decades. So this is not a laughing matter. This is very serious. And that takes me to the EU. Elmar, what, if any, are the lessons learned that you draw from our earlier attempts at creating a more capable and proactive European Union? And what, if anything, should the European Union do now, both on, you know, Ukraine and on the Syrian drama? Is there more than aid to refugees? Can we develop a strategic approach? You have the floor, sir.
Thank you very much. I think that not much reason to laugh. I think the European Union was able to react in a proper way on the Ukrainian crisis. All the member states in the European Union have decided not to wage war with that because of that, but give the aggressor a message that aggression is expensive. That is the sanctions. And just this week, that was decided to continue that. And if 1.5 years ago, someone would have told me that 28 nations were able to do so, I wouldn't believe it. I think that's incredible progress in joint European policy that should be taken note of. And we pay more, our companies, our citizens pay more for that at the United States because of the economic relationship. Despite that, that was achieved and we continue that. If Minsk will not be implemented, it were two European statesmen, and with the support of the European Union, Mrs. Merkel and Mr. Hollande, to create it Minsk. And what we work on now is to find a way to implement Minsk. Whether that will be successful or not, I do not know. But I know that the sanction would be continued if Minsk were not successful. It will not be implemented. And but I must say also another question, that has to do with the Syrian question. I think the European Union and her high representative, Vice President of the Commission, played an important role in the Iran negotiations. That then was done by the European Union. They led the negotiations and led it to a success story. And it shows that we have this ability. And I think we should take note of that and use that experience. I believe that the United States and the European Union should come together in New York to find an agreement with Russia on that. Because Russia played in the Iran question a very constructive role. And we know that in that environment, it's nothing doable without Russia. And we want to have an agreement and the same position of these three countries' groups. And it's the only chance to talk to Saudi Arabia, Iran, and Ankara to play the proper role. What we have in that region is a proxy war, where religion is used as an alibi for regional power, mostly of Tehran and Riyadh. And if we do not break that, we can have boots on the grounds, or have boots on the grounds, and the Russians have boots on the grounds, cooperate they or work they against each other, if there are different strategies. And therefore, only that boots on the grounds makes sense. It's a common strategy. Also with Russia, they are there. Whether we like it or not, they are there. And therefore, I think it's needed to see that in a Ukrainian question, we are very clear and we have no agreement with Russia and we do not accept the violation of international law, but there must be other parts of the world where we can cooperate. And here is also Russia has an interest. If I see the development of ISIS in republics in the Caucasus, then we have a joint interest. And for the first time also Riyadh and Tehran have a joint interest because both of them do not like ISIS. The result, what we have all together created, us and the Arabian countries and Iran, is now a common threat. And I think on that basis we can discuss that and find us together. And here we'll play everyone a role, and we know it's not France or Germany. We have a joint strategy as the European Union. Otherwise we do not play an equal role in that game or not. And therefore I hope that the next week in New York and the week after we'll play an important role in these questions.
Mustafa, let me ask you the following question. Let's assume that there is actually going to be a real meeting, a discussion between President Putin and President Obama and maybe with others, including the European powers. How afraid are you that what will then happen is that the issue of Crimea will be sacrificed on the altar of some kind of entente between the big powers? Where is Ukraine going to be once the big understanding has happened.
Thank you. And first of all, thank you for your support of Ukrainian integrity of Ukraine about this glorious annexation, yes, and distortion of reality, actually, because for us it's obvious and for all the world it's about annexation. And about this crisis, I would say, even now our conversation is what is about, to solve problem or to satisfy Russia? This is the biggest question we have now. And we don't know in Ukraine what is the answer for that. Because during last months, last year, we see that Europe hesitated, but now they're strong and they are united around Ukraine. And we are very successful in that. And the question now is that even that conversation between Mr. Obama and Putin will be held, what is the goal of Mr. Obama? To solve the problem, and then you have experience. We have Minsk Agreement, and we as Ukrainians, we are calling to all world, don't be hostages. Because you are hostages of Russian strategy. They're making problem, and they're putting some cards on the table, and then you're choosing from that card, but it's, you know, it's not enough. Because they didn't fulfill nothing from Minsk Agreement for about in 1 year. Nothing. Nothing at all. We did everything from our side. We even changed constitution. We had problem with that in our country, with our old parliament. Our president had problem in his own country because of Minsk Agreement. But we did it. We fulfilled all requirements. And what we see from the other side? Nothing. They're going to hold election on that territory which are annexed. They're going to hold election territory which is occupied, but it's not Minsk Agreement. So if you will have this conversation with Mr. Putin, I think the first thing you should ask is to fulfill requirements of Minsk Agreement. It should be first step that we should believe them. Who should we trust? Or we are going to do the same mistake again. Europe had the same situation in 1939. You had Gdansk, when France refused to support Poland, and we had World War II. Are we going to do the same things now? Are we going to let them go farther just because they're making problems in different parts of the world for us? Then I'm asking, for what we did these sanctions all this time? Where is our values? So I would say that this conversation is very, very important. We should listen to each other. We should be reasonable. But at least at the first time, we should say, what are we going to do? Solve problem or satisfy aggression?
Jack, let me go back to you. There will be later, following our panel here, a discussion about the U.S., roles of the U.S. and Russia. And I don't want to preempt that discussion. But, of course, some 20 years ago or so, Richard Holbrooke wrote this piece in Foreign Affairs about the United States as a European power. If you consider yourselves a European power, how are you going to square the circle between, you know, respecting the aspirations of Ukraine, taking them into account, and at the same time accepting the fact that there is not going to be, probably, a solution for the Syrian catastrophe unless we have some degree of cooperation with Russia on this. And at the end of the day, as Foreign Minister Steinmeier doesn't tire to say, there is also probably not going to be a long-term sustainable solution to the conflict in Ukraine unless we find some kind of accommodation with Russia. So how do you square the circle? What's first, what's second? What are your priorities from an American point of view?
I think that basically we have a situation here where we have to walk and chew gum at the same time. In the sense that there's no reason to think that we are not going to deal with Russia. We did it with Iran. We can do it in other areas where we need to do that. And by the way, we did that with the Soviet Union. In other words, there were opportunities to deal with people that you have absolutely different opinions on in one area and still continue to talk with them in another. I agree with you, and I'm going to use a vernacular here. I'd love to know what the German translation is, but I think the Russians made mincemeat out of Minsk. And I'm not entirely sure how many Minsks we're going to have out there. I remember Mr. Schulz in the EU saying that we will have Minsk 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. How many Minsks can there be, Elmar? And it seems to me that the problem that we also have is that the US, and getting to your question, you know, considers itself still to be a European partner. I think that to some extent, however, what we've seen, particularly in the last couple of decades, is a US that's looking more and more toward Europe for, as what the minister said before, Minister von der Leyen, securing its own security. So we're going to have a situation where the US is going to be looking differently at the equation between power sharing and burden sharing and security sharing. That's not going to be what it was in the 20th century. And I think that to some extent that's going to inevitably involve a discussion with Moscow on a number of issues. But we're certainly going to read you the Riot Act when it comes to telling you what we don't agree with. And just let me to say one historical point. We waited 50 years after the invasion of the Baltic states in 1939 to 1940 and found that in 1990, 91, those countries were once again sovereign. We can wait.
Sergei, after what happened, and given the diametrically opposed narratives that we've extensively discussed in our group and which just appeared, you think of, you know, a glorious homecoming of Crimea, and not only Mustafa, but I think the majority here believes that this was an illegal act under international law of annexation. Given these diametrically opposed narratives, how possible and how credible and how useful would be a reaffirmation of the principles of the Charter of Paris? Does that make sense? Is Russia interested in that? In other words, can we continue to work on the basis of what we thought we had, which is now shattered? Voila.
Let's put it this way. I mean, my country had great illusions and great hopes when we signed the Charter of Paris. But then we had what we believe a rerun of Versailles policy in velvet gloves, with the Western sphere of influence, I mean, moving closer and closer, and control, including military control, to our borders, including to the territories which we deem to be absolutely vital to our security and for which we spent tens of millions of lives. First. Second, we also saw that when Soviet Union stopped rough containment and deterrence of the West got amok. I mean, a rape of Yugoslavia, 3 months of bombardment of a peaceful country, Libyan aggression, and Iraq. So I think that what we had is a complete collapse of the world order, of the dream which we had 25 years ago. Could we return back? I hope. But then we have to understand that our policy, that we are all miserable failures, that we Russians too, by the way, because we were weak. We introduced badly managed reforms because we wanted to be liked and we wanted to be by our Western friends, and we didn't tell truth. But now we're telling you truth. And I hope that this whole affair around Ukraine, and by the way, people like myself and officials have been telling for years our Western counterpart, don't get close to Ukraine, there'll be war. And that happened. I hope now that that very bitter lesson will be learned. I hope that we will come back to our senses and start to recreate some kind of a common system of security based on more or less on the same principles, with an addition of two or three, like a complete ban on export of value systems. We exported communism, which was a brilliant idea created by Karl Marx, and I mean, a lot of countries suffered, including the countries of the Baltics. And now the democracy is being exported, and what happens is we see the results all over the Middle East, and we see the results in Ukraine. Because, I mean, you wanted to export your Western values, systems, etc., and Ukraine, which was a very fragile country, now is, I hope it will survive.
So what you're saying?
What I'm saying is let's go back to the principles, but also add some meat to them. And then start to build up a new system. But this time I think we failed so bitterly in Europe, and we failed so bitterly so many times. Versailles, Paris. My idea is that we probably, it is for us to decide and to propose in our group that in the old European structure, we could not recreate that. Let's try a wider framework and maybe create a new structure of cooperation on the Eurasian level.
So what you're saying is export of oil and gas, okay, export of democracy, no.
Export of democracy, of anything, democracy, communism, Christianity, more Muslim thinking, etc., etc. I mean, we have had that history in Europe, and we have had terrible wars. By the way, democracy is much better than any of the isms which we have been exporting to each other. But when you started to export it to the countries which were not ready to take them, you have a problem. And that is a problem of the which is most vivid in the Middle East. And I must say that Ukraine is a democratic country. But because of the export of democracy, it is now four times, as far as I remember, four times as poor per capita as it used to be in comparison with, for example, Russia or Belarus 25 years ago.
So what this means is probably that if we can reaffirm our principle, Helsinki principles, Charter of Paris principles, Russia would want to add a principle which, in my language, could sound like the principle of the incontestability of political systems. Whether we're willing to accept that as a principle, we'll see. Let me change.
The systems should be changed, but from within.
Yeah.
And by the will of the people.
Not from outside. Let me ask the two of you a question, because Sergei, of course, spoke of failure. Speaking of failure, you know, our EU security strategy of 2003 spoke of, and I quote from the text, a ring of well-governed states to the east and south of the EU. That was the vision. Instead, of course, we have failed completely. We have chaos in the south, and we have war in the east. In other words, the 2003 vision has not only not been completed or implemented, it has totally failed to be achieved. What happened, and where would you, I mean, important representatives of two European countries, you inside the European Parliament, you an important advisor, what is your, how do we move forward?
I would just like to make just a remark concerning the Helsinki Final Act and mm-hmm. Which was absolutely primary, which was the free flow of people and information, and which is, I mean, what do you do with export of propaganda? I mean, we have here a main problem. It's not a free flow of information and people, but this is a reversal of it.
Yeah, 95% of what you read about Russia is propaganda, and 98% of what I read about your policy is propaganda. I'm sorry. But that's, let's ban propaganda. I mean, but that
not,
is
not,
a very
not,
hard
principle. Not every information
okay,
propaganda.
Yeah. Yeah. But that is also propaganda.
Yes, that is also.
We will never agree on that point.
Okay.
But let's try to offer two brief views on what should be the EU response to its own failure. Do you want to start?
The Ring of Friends, I mean, we completely failed concerning the Ring of Friends was more a security belt. This was conceived as trying to have a forward security surrounding the European Union. And we didn't stick by our standard. In particular, the French government did not stick to its standards in Tunisia. This is a blatant failure of supporting, not exporting, we never exported, supporting democracy in other countries. We should really, this is where Professor Winkler was absolutely right. We should correct our mistakes here and really support democratic forces inside the countries that we didn't do before. So there is a lot of to do here. We did better probably in Eastern Europe, in particular in those countries that are maybe important for Russian security, where we supported democratic forces. But in the south of Europe, in the east of Europe, southeast of Europe, in the Arab world, we failed miserably.
Elmar?
Half is full, half empty. What we did after 1990 is that with the enlargement of the European Union, we have now very successful states. Poland is an example for that. So it's not a total failure. We have now 28 nations of democracy and a developing economy. And the same way as Poland went, Ukraine want to go. Therefore, I can say you not accept your formulation. Helsinki, all these agreements mean territorial integrity and sovereignty of the nations. These two points Russia has violated. And the Ukrainian people have decided since every elections in the 90s, even the referendum for independence, that they want to go the Western way. It doesn't matter which government. And they want a transformation process. And the Ukrainians tell me, in 1990, the GNP of Poland and Ukraine was more or less the same. And we want to make a transformation process as Poland, then we would be in a better shape. And therefore, what we want is democracy, the rule of law, independent judiciary, fighting corruption. And I think that the people on the Maidan were and have the European colors showing that. They wanted to do that, and Mr. Putin became afraid. If the Ukraine would become a democracy under the rule of law, against corruption, the economic success story, there is no reason for the Putin system anymore in Russia, and it cannot be blamed on its people. That's a fight we have. We have to support the Ukraine to make the transformation process a success story. Help them to organize it better. We are on the way. There's much progress in that field of transformation in the last 9 months since the government is in power. Not by far not enough. But we have to make that success story in that part where the Ukrainian government had the administrative authority to tell to the other systems that the values of democracy, liberal democracy, rule of law, and market economy within the European context is for our people the better way. And the Ukrainians want to do that, and the Russians stop to them. And they're in Ukraine in order to stabilize this, in order to make this transformation process unimpossible. And that is against these values where we stand for. And this, I think, is a violation of every agreement.
I want to take a couple of questions from the audience in just a minute. So if I see
But
I want to ask you, Mustafa, are you satisfied with the efforts made by your own government? Do you think enough is being done to change what used to be a system of pervasive corruption? Is the fight determined enough? I was in Kiev a week ago, and some of my other friends who were also there have come back with some degree of doubt whether there is enough being done at the moment. And if you think there is not enough being done, is there more we can do, we Europeans, to help Ukraine get rid of the problems and move forward and stabilize itself from the inside? Please.
Yes, thank you. First of all, you know, I'm a little bit wondered. The thing is that we are talking about a king like about some object. This is big country, 40 million people. We are not living in time of slavery that some country can say it's my territory, don't approach. And we were not slave of Russians. We were, and we are, free country with our own destiny and dignity. And what we did, we just decided to change our way, because what we had Mr. Yanukovych regime and we didn't agree with his way. That's why we did it. And we changed it. Who can dictate us not to do that? No one, just Ukraine people. And regarding the war, then Russia that told it, don't approach, you will have war. Now they recognize that they did this war. Not our troops are on the Russian territory, but Russian troops on our territory. Not we annexed Kuban, yes? They annexed Crimea. So they recognized it. They made this war because they didn't want Ukraine to escape this destiny of post-Soviet countries. Look at the Armenia. We don't want to have this destiny, unfortunately. Look at the Belarus. This, we don't want that. About corruption and what we did in our country. You know, I think even in Germany, people are not satisfied with the government. In all countries, people are not satisfied. We are not satisfied because we want to be quicker and want to be more mature in that. But 1 year ago, when I was a journalist, we met with our president that time, it was Mr. Tuchinov. And you know what? When war started, we didn't have any unit to move. I mean, military unit. Nothing. First time when we saw Russian troops in our territory, we could do nothing just because volunteers went there. When I saw first Ukrainian tank, I was happy as a boy, just because I even couldn't imagine that we have these tanks. Because previous regime of Mr. Yanukovych destroyed our military forces to the ground, to the zero, yes? So what we did through this year, we built strong army. And all what is going on here in this room, this discussion is just because our people are dying on the front line. All our success, European Union and our president and all values could be done just because of our people resisting. Just imagine that Russian troops now are in Kyiv. Could we discuss that? No. Just because our people resist. And we are doing that. And I want to remind you, Ukraine is only one country in the world in which people are dying with the European Union flag. It's not going on in France. It's not going on in Germany. It's not going on in Poland. It's Ukrainians. What we did during this year, we didn't have systematic corruption. We have sins. It's true, but we recognize it. But when I heard about this from Russian, you know, in which people are starving and authorities are burning cheese and apples because they're from Europe, we are transparent and we are open and we recognize that we have some problems. But what we did, first of all, in our country, now we have security service and security departments, police, which is supported by 80% of people. Show me other country in post-Soviet countries in which police and militia, most corrupted structure, is supported by 82%. It's reality. We can handle it. The other thing, yesterday in our parliament was arrested several members of parliament now because of corruption. We resigned oligarchs from our cabinets. They are not there. They are still influenceable in Ukraine. They still have media, but we are persistent in that way. We will not stop on that. So in that term, if you see that it was happened for 1 year during war, and we didn't have assistance from all countries from the first days. Because if you compare, for example, what you did for Greece, it's unfair, but I want to remind you something.
That's a little bit unfair.
I will say you something. You know, I know that you don't like it, but
13 billion alone from the European Union.
But,
13 billion.
But at the same time, you spent more than 200 billion for Greece, and you have pro-Russian government there.
I have not spent it, credits.
Okay, but we don't have even that. Ask your people here. Yeah. So, but we are still going that way. So we will do that.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We don't. I'll get back to you in a minute. Our time is quickly running out. So I would like to recognize maybe one or two people who have questions. If you could, of course, we'll start with the gentleman behind Mr. Matusek. If you could identify yourself and maybe tell us to which of the members of the panel your question is addressed, or to all, please.
Hi, this is Manisha Shamsghizi, and my panel goes to Elma. This might be a generational thing, but for 20-something, there is a bunch of us here in the room. A lot of these discussions sound like the ghosts of the 20th century in geopolitics. And I know this is all very relevant, so this is just an add-on. Seeing young people on both sides, as well as here in the European Union, what can we do on a soft power level that might not be the focus and the most important thing to be done, but how can especially European Union make sure that the young people on both sides can exchange and start on building on like the next decades while we still try to control, I mean, the last decades that won't let us go into peaceful 21st century? That would be a question. The European Union's soft power. Thank you.
Okay, let's collect maybe two or three questions. Let's go to the gentleman all the way in the back, second row from the back. And then we'll go to the first row. And then is there somebody here in the middle who is asking a question? No. Okay, please.
Thank you very much. I would like to connect to the person who just talked about the soft power. I'm also a representative of the civil society, so for me it's really overwhelming to see how the civil society in Germany was the leading force in this refugee crisis we are experiencing now. The politics followed, actually, in Germany. So if we see how values were tried to be exported in the last century, and we know that this didn't work. It doesn't work to export democracy by military force.
Could you ask a question?
Yes.
Please?
The question is, how could the elite of the political level connect much more to the potential of the civil society we have in Europe? And that is also not only to the civil society and the potential there in terms of supporting refugees, but also to make sure that the split inside the society between those who want to support and those who are afraid and refrain to criminal acts could be more moderated in terms of more exchange. I think we have a huge potential here. Not only in Europe and Germany, but
I think
worldwide.
We understand the question.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Annegut Herkes, who is a member of the board of Herrhausen Gesellschaft, here in the first row.
Thank you very much. My question is directed to the European members on the panel. In 2013, when the European Union signed the agreement with Ukraine, we knew that Russia would show a hostile and very averse reaction to the transformation project that we were on our way to undertake, and which I, of course, fully support. Where was the EU's preventive diplomacy and foresight at the time that would have prevented that we go down in this unprecedented crisis in Europe? Thank you.
Okay, and then I have to go to the gentleman behind you, Jungen, the gentleman with the blonde hair, yes, the tall one.
Thank you. My name is Eric Gens. I'm a scholar of foreign policy and European foreign policy. I have a question to the crisis management. With all the crisis around Europe, we see a kind of mini-lateralism in the sense that the Visegrad Group, the E3 plus 3, Weimar Triangle, and all the others are coming together to solve problems. And I would ask a bit boldly to all members whether you think that is a good solution, because they get things done and not like the EU of 28, who's too slow, too little, too late. Thank you.
Okay, we're running out of time. I apologize to Herr Jungen and to others who wanted to ask questions, but I'm told that we have to come to an end. So I will give to each one of you, if you wish, time for a one-minute final answer. We start with you, Sergei.
Russia has taught the West the lesson that it should respect its interests. I hope the West has taught us that it has the will also to fight to its values. If we decide that we taught each other well, let us think about the future now. A Ukrainian crisis will not be solved by Ukrainians or by Russians or by Europeans. It could be solved if we solve the underlying problem of the Ukrainian crisis and help Ukraine together to get out. Ukraine has been an independent country for 20 more years and was going from bad to worse in terms of corruption and in terms of economic development. I hope that Mustafa is right, that in 1 year everything has changed. I think I am doubtful that Ukraine could survive and prosper without common help from abroad, from both sides.
Thank you. That was 2 minutes. Anne-Marie.
Just briefly to soft power. I mean, the EU has soft power. The minister was saying before our panel that the European countries and Union are attracting refugees because they want to live according to Western universal standards. And this is what they are looking for, by the way, not only refugees, but sometimes oligarchs and people from other countries that are offshoring to London, for instance, because of the rule of law and high schools and so whatsoever and so forth. Soft power doesn't make op-eds most of the time. The EU has soft power in very many ways, like education, like supporting Erasmus and all the world program. And there are very, very many things, humanitarian actions. This does not make op-ed, right? But it has. And unfortunately, we are not living in a nice little sweet world. And the 21st century is going to be worse than the 20th. So we better need be prepared for also having some kinds of security to defend ourselves. And I really regret that the European Union is not really the format in which it can happen, and that European countries, generally speaking, are too weak on military power. I wish it were not only NATO ready to defend the security of Europe, but other countries, European countries themselves.
Thank you very much. Mustafa.
Thank you. First of all, I would say my Russian colleague, yes, we don't need assistant, please. Not that way, yes. Came to Kyiv, just let this discussion be held there. You know, I have a very interesting background because I'm from Afghanistan. I was born there, and you know, my country was occupied by Russians. I mean, not Russian Soviets at that time. And I see the consequence of that war. What we are doing now is that we are destroying people's ability to live in peace on their territories, on Donbas. And it will be our responsibility, because it's our territory, it's our people. They are Ukrainians, yes? But you are destroying that on your border. Actually, you're not doing something good for yourself. And if you're asking about what is doubt or not doubt, Ukraine will survive. This year, one thing changed is that we understood that we should rely on ourselves. We need unity of international society. We need unity of Europe, United States. We need this assistance, even yours. Just do it in proper way. But we should rely on ourselves. And we are going to survive in even more. We will define our own way without any threat from other side.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. Elmar?
I think we believe until 2013 that we have a Europe for eternal peace since 1990. That was wrong. And therefore, I believe soft power has only credibility if everyone knows that hard power is behind it. And here we have until failures, but Mr. Putin is helping us to make us aware of that. And therefore, we are on a way to develop not only just European foreign, but also security policy, and I hope the nation states will see that. We spent 190 billion euros, the member states, for defense for no result, because there's no synergy effects, no results. Secondly, Moscow has given too oft support to nations who do not want to have the support. And therefore, it's up to them. That is the modern policy of the 21st century. Sovereignty of the nations. They have to decide in which system. If the Ukrainian would decide in election to go to the Eurasian Union, it's fine for me. But let them decide what they want. That's a decisive point. In the 21st century, we should keep territorial integrity and sovereignty on nations. And I couldn't believe until it happened that in this century, after you signed the modern Budapest Memorandum, you would in military intervene in a country. And when you say reunification with Ukraine, with Crimea, if you take that you have historical rights and all these other feelings, can you tell 100 spots in Europe you can wage war? That should be finished and should not ever happen in Europe again. And that was our understanding of Paris Charter, of Helsinki, and so on and so on. We should come back to that policy. Then we can have the proper transformation process in a country like Ukraine. They do the transformation process despite the enemies in the country in which is war against this country. That's the situation we face. Let the Ukrainian decide what they want, and then let's support them as they want it. That would be the way to build a modern Europe.
Final minute, Jack.
Well said. I will end where I started. Vision without execution is hallucination. I think that we are living in a world, as Professor Winkler suggested, where we're looking for orientation. It's no longer an asymmetric world. It is a multipolar world. Some people say it's an apolar world. Some people even say it's no one's world. And I think that's what our big challenge is. And I think it's our challenge is
never do it like in Iraq and Libya.
Well, we'll get into that later. But in any event, the point is that with Professor Winkler's admonition, we should say we need to restore what that vision is. We need to execute that vision, and we need to do it together. And I think that's why we're all here today.
I was going to say let's give a hand of applause to our wonderful panel. You've already done that. So let me thank you for listening and participating so actively. I apologize to the organizers for overstepping the time limit, but I thought this was worth the effort. Thank you again.